So what is torsional vibration? Well, if I showed you an RPM versus time curve, right, we're measuring the speed of some rotating component over the course of 19 seconds or so. And we see the speed is increasing, the rotations per minute is increasing. But what is a little bit unusual about this curve? Well, if you look at it, it's kind of what I would call hairy. And if we zoom in on the RPM trace, we see that there's actually these up and down speed fluctuations, where the RPM isn't just a steady increasing number, it's actually oscillating about some mean value. And that's what torsional vibration is. Torsional vibration is speed fluctuations up and down of a rotating component, okay? So there it is in a nice quotation format. But so it's up and down speed fluctuation of a rotating piece, okay? And what we want to do with our measurements for torsional vibration is understand, you know, the amount of vibration we have, and then, you know, what operating conditions that torsional vibration is occurring, so that we have some idea what the root cause is, and then we can go work on that root cause and hopefully improve our torsional vibration situation. So where does torsional vibration come from? And you're going to notice something consistent through all of these sources, and that's things stopping and starting or moving back and forth. And so if you have an internal combustion engine, you have periodic explosions happening, right? Detonation events in each of the cylinders, and that's happening once every two revolutions of the crankshaft for a given cylinder. And so you have these torque fluctuations, right? It does not produce a consistent or nominal amount of torque. It's actually coming in these pulses. And so just like a, you know, bumps on a road, inducing vibration in a linear vibration system, torque pulses or torque fluctuation causes torsional vibration in a rotational system. Okay, so not only do we have these periodic combustion events, but we also have all these reciprocating pieces, and each of them has, you know, mass. Put that mass in motion, we have inertia. And to move it back and forth, it's going to cause some forces, and that's one of the main culprits in a combustion engine. For an electric motor, obviously we don't have any combustion going on, but we have some permanent magnets as well as some magnetized coils. And so as this rotor rotates inside the stator, the magnets want to hold the state of the rotor in certain locations, right? And so you'll get what's called cogging torque. And so if you've ever turned a little electric motor by hand, you can feel it kind of start and stop at however many poles or permanent magnets you have in your electric motor. This is going to produce a torque fluctuation as that motor starts beginning to spin. As well as in an electric vehicle application, you have all kinds of transferal of electricity from DC batteries to AC motors, and all of this is going on back and forth between AC and DC, and that's done by computerized switches that are turning the DC power on and off, very high rate of speed, and so that is going to also create some torque fluctuations. If you have a really long shaft, perhaps you have a universal joint, one of these guys that you see in the little animation here. And depending on the angle of the two shafts or the angle between the two shafts, the universal joint does not transmit a constant rotational speed. The speed goes up and down as the shaft rotates. The input shaft rotates 360 degrees. The velocity of the output shaft is actually going up and down a couple times, as you see there. And so depending on, you know, how long our shaft is, we have any kind of universal joint in it, this is in, you know, inputting some torsional vibration or torque fluctuations in our shafts, and that could be another source. Then with any kind of friction element, like a clutch, as that interface begins to be right on the edge between locked or a stick condition and full slip condition, you can have this sort of alternation between the kinetic coefficient of friction and the static coefficient of friction. And that starting and stopping obviously can create some torque pulses and instigate some torsional vibration as well. And then if you have gears that are meshing together, you can have lash between those gears, or this is sort of free play between the meshing components. And so anytime you have a change in direction between rotating systems with gears, or there's a reversal of power flow. So if you go from, you know, a run up to a run down in a rotational system with gears, you can have this lash in that change of directions. These gears sort of alternate which face they're contacting their partner, and that can instigate one of these torque fluctuations as well. Okay, so all these places are where some torsional vibration can come from. Many rotating systems have some or all of these, or multiple or all of these in them all at once. And so plenty of opportunity to develop torsional vibration in a rotating system. Additionally, if you have shafts, they all have rotational natural frequencies or modes where they want to vibrate, like we see in this crankshaft here, where the, you know, we're used to sort of oscillating systems where a mass is moving back and forth with a spring mass system. Same thing exactly happens in a rotational sense for long shafts, is that there are places and frequencies where the shaft wants to rotate, and you have torsional modes of vibration just like you do with bending modes of vibration. And so what does this torsional vibration cost us? What is the reason we care about it? Well, all of this rotating and bending motion causes vibration. Excessive vibration can certainly reduce comfort for something like, you know, a driver on a vehicle. You're driving a riding lawnmower, you never actuated or engaged the blades. You notice that there's this big sort of period of vibration. That is a big torque fluctuation, right? All that mass of those blades has to start up, and that causes the rotating system to deal with some torsional vibration. So if that happened over and over or to a certain level, it can certainly reduce your comfort, as well as noise problems, right? As these gears start to rattle back and forth, as you start to you know, have booming noises from long shafts bending under certain torsional vibration conditions, you can certainly create noise problems. And all of this excessive vibration will lead to durability problems, right? Tooth wear on gears, flex couplings, that clutch plate that we looked at, all of that extra vibration and sticking and slipping can cause additional wear. And so this is obviously a durability problem. You have all this synchronization going on, right, between maybe an internal combustion engine and your transmission and then your wheels. All of that has to be synchronized and can actually cause a reduction in fuel economy or drive quality when you have synchronization problems. So all of these things, we would like to minimize torsional vibration.